Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex with the title Backfeeding, Hunting for the Unintentional Power Path. My name is Peter Lischer. I'm a senior hardware development engineer at Toradex. I'm working for Toradex now since 14 years. If you have ever used a Toradex computer module in the past, the chances are actually pretty high that I was involved in the hardware development of this module. Before we dive into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and you wish to let us know. At the end, we will have an interactive question and answer session. So you can type your questions into the chat window at any time, and we will pick them up at the end. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing in a few days from today. What is on today's agenda? I will start with a really brief introduction of Toradex for the few of you which don't know Toradex so far. We will talk then about the backfeeding itself, what it is and how it is coming from, so how it is originating. We'll talk about potential issues that then can be caused. And we will try then to identify backfeeding on a system design level. So actually before you have started your schematics. Later, I will show you some methods I'm using for hunting and measuring backfeeding on a prototype and show you then a lot of different methods to prevent backfeeding in schematic and other ways to prevent it. I will show you then in the last part an example of backfeeding. I will explain how the backfeeding on this special situation happened and what we do with it against it. And as promised, in the end of the session, we will have the question and answer. With that, let's start with the introduction of Toradex. Toradex is focusing on making embedded computing easy to use so that you get simple access to the latest technology for your product development. We are doing this by providing highly reliable ARM system on modules, which include software and support. We are striving to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you, and this doesn't just mean the module price, but it also takes in consideration aspects like development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance. We are proud of being able to have industry-leading support, which includes a very active community and a developer page with more than 800 articles that are updated on a daily basis. As you can see on this map here, we have offices all around the world with local support and warehouses. Our headquarters is in Horb, Lucerne, Switzerland. This is also where I'm located if I'm not in the home office. We are selling computer modules. This is our main business. The computer modules we have are in three different families. We have the Apalis, the Colibri, and our latest family, the Verdin family. Within the family, the modules are all pin compatible in their main functions. This means you can develop your board for a specific module and then later swap it for a one with higher performance or lower power consumption or lower price maybe, so you can optimize your design. The modules itself, they also come with software support. So we have our Linux BSP based on the Yocto. On some of the modules, we have Windows CE support, we have FreeRTOS, Android, and we have our own operating system that is called Torizon. What are our typical applications? So our customers are using it for industrial automation. We have a lot of customers using our boards in healthcare situations. for transportation. Of course, test and measurement is a really important part, and also smart cities. Our typical customers are having projects in the range of a few hundred pieces up to a few 10,000 pieces per year. Toradex itself, we have more than 1,000 active customers. With that, let's start with the main topic for today. So, what exactly is backfeeding? I mean, backfeeding itself has multiple names. We in Toradex, we call it backfeeding, but maybe you have already heard terms like backflow or backdriving, reverse current, reverse feeding, or you may use your own term for it. So it's kind of hard to find something in the internet when you have so many different ways for so many different names for it. For the beginning, I want to show you this video here. That's a board that is in which we unplug the power, and it still kind of seems to kind of work. So the LEDs are still on. There's kind of blinking when you unplug the power until you unplug the USB port. So this board here somehow gets powered by the USB port, but it gets into really strange stage because the LEDs are blinking, so it's not really working well anymore because this powering from the USB port is completely unintentional here. So we are backfeeding from the USB port on this board. I will explain exactly what is going on this board in the end of my presentation. That will be our little example in which we dive in what's going on here. But for now, let's see what's happening on I/O pins. We have here a very simple little block diagram or schematic of a peripheral connected to the module which has an SoC on it. We have an I/O which is originated at the peripheral. So the peripheral is having an output here which drives the signal into the SoC. Of course, there is a small current here going from the peripheral to the SoC. But this is not backfeeding. This is just a regular signal current. That's not what we call backfeeding. What happens if we turn off the I/O rail on the module side? We still have this current here going into it. So this is still not backfeeding because we are missing a really important piece here in this whole thing. So, have you ever seen on a data sheet of a peripheral device, of a chip, that IOs, the maximum voltage ratings for IO pins are very often given with this little formula here? They're not having absolute values, so they are specified with the IO rail plus 0.3 volt. Why they are doing that? Why they're not giving us here the absolute values. The reason for it is that you have internal ESD protection on this chip. This is, by the way, it's a CAN transceiver here. You have internal ESD protection. On most pins, this internal ESD protection looks something like this, that you have two diodes here inside the chip itself. One diode is coming from the I/O pin up to the I/O rail, and the other one from the ground. These ones are protecting the pins on a really basic level. So for very often you only have a level of 1 kilovolt for a human body model or 250 volt for a charge device model. This is not enough as a protection for real world connectors, anything. For real-world connectors, you still need external protection diodes. This protection is meant during production, that you don't kill already the chip during production. It's really a basic protection here. But the thing is that this diode here, up here, that limits the input voltage of this I/O pin. So if that I/O pin here goes more than 0.3 volt higher than the I/O rail here, then this Schottky diode can get conductive. That's where this formula is coming from. And now when we turn off our IORail on the module side, on the SOC side, we get into the problem that this diode here gets into forward biasing, and we have a strong current, or a stronger current than actually the signal current, from the peripheral rail through the output buffer here into the ESD diode to the IORail. So that one is lifting up our IORail, which means we are going to have a residual voltage on our IORail. This is backfeeding. Of course, you can have backfeeding also the other way around, so that our module is the output, and you have a peripheral here, which you have turned off. Maybe you have turned it off for saving some power in certain situations that you don't need that peripheral. So you want to save some power, so you turn it off. And what can happen here is that you actually also backfeed to the peripheral rail here, and you have some residual voltage on the peripheral. You can have also backfeeding on open drain signal. So when you have a pull-up here that is still pulled up while everything else is off, so you can have also here some backfeeding. Of course, the pull-up resistor itself, it limits a little bit the current, so it is a lesser problem as a regular push-pull output. What are the potential issues with backfeeding? So the first thing you can have is really unexpected behavior, that certain part of your board are running even though they're not supposed to run, that you may consume more power in that situation. That's just the board doesn't behave how we want to have it in standby, in sleep modes, in off stages. You could have problems with power on resets. A lot of peripheral device, they don't have a dedicated reset input. So what they do is they monitor their input voltages. And if it rises above a certain level, they release their own power on reset. And if it goes down a certain level, they go into reset stage. But the problem is, if your residual voltage is too high, that you may release the power on reset too early in a situation in which you don't want to have it released. Or when you do a power cycle, maybe the residual voltage doesn't go low enough that you go into reset, so that your chip never gets reset, so that your really your registers and everything in the chip is on a stage that you don't expect. The same goes with strapping. A lot of devices have strapping pins in which you can set it to different modes. This is normally something that is read out during a power up sequence. After going through a certain threshold, the pins are read out. But if you have residual voltage, the pins may get read out at wrong stage and get wrong signals. So you may be strapping your device wrong. Maybe you have some LEDs which are on or just slightly glowing or even blinking or oscillating. That's what we have seen in the video before. I had even boards that were making audible noise because some buck or boost converters, they were in stages which were not intended, so kind of wrong voltages, and then really went into audible frequencies. You can violate power up and power down sequences of your devices that are required, and this can lead to latch up situations. Latch up could even destroy a board or a chip. And of course, since the current is coming through an I/O pin, you can actually overload this I/O pin. And with it, you could overload or damage your ESD protection on the input side. Because ESD protection diodes, they're only made for short currents or short voltage, short lasting voltages. They're not made for long exposure to current, so that you can overload them thermally. And of course, something you almost always violate is the ratings for the absolute maximum voltage. Because again, we have here this this formula here in the data sheet, which says IO voltage rail plus 0.3 volt. If you turn off the IO voltage rail, of course, you're not allowed to give more than 0.3 volt to an IO pin. I mean, and if you violate absolute maximum ratings, the vendor of the chip doesn't guarantee you anything, whether it's lasting, whether it's having some long-term damages or anything. With that, I would like to go into the first poll. We would like to make a short break. So I would like to know from you, what were the biggest backfeeding issues you have faced in the past? Was it unexpected behavior like reset, power on reset, which wasn't working, wrong strapping, or just strange behavior? Did you have seen some glowing LEDs in the past or light up LEDs? Did you ever had some audible noises? Did you ever had some damaged devices? Or have you been lucky and never had any backfeeding issues? Okay, I give you a few more seconds. Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to close it and I'm going to share the results with you. So it's really interesting, the results. So most of you, almost 50% of you have had unexpected behavior in the past. And of course, glowing LEDs are really something you see a lot. But you were also having 5% of you were having already damaged devices. So really serious problem with it. So with that, let's go ahead and see what we can do against backfeeding and how we can identify backfeeding. So the first thing, of course, is that we should identify backfeeding before designing our board, because before going into schematic design in an early stage. And for that, it's really important that you understand your block diagram and where your power domains are. So we have here an example of a vertical board that has a camera, an SD card, an HDMI display connected to it, and we have a host PC which we use for debugging over RS-232, so read out the terminal over the RS-232 port. So we have that system, and we have to identify now the different power domains. Power domains are power rails that are turned on and off together, so that always are on and off in the same stage. So try to make lines around your power domains. For example, here, I set the lines this way here, that I can put this RS-232 transceiver in this situation to the same power domain as the Verdin module, because we're using here the power 1.8 volt Mach-E rail from the module to power up the transceiver. This power 1.8 volt Mach-E signal is a power output of the module, which is exactly turning on and off together with the module. So that means as long as we are using that one, the transceiver itself should be on the same domain as the module. But of course, the host PC itself, this is in a completely different power domain, because it can be turned on while the whole Verdin board is turned off and vice versa. The same goes with the HDMI display. So the HDMI display is powered from, can be powered while the board is on, or can be unpowered while the Verdin module is powered off. But even onboard peripherals, like here the camera, can be in a different power domain. If we use, for example, the control sleep Mach-E signal to turn on and off the power rails for the camera in sleep, for example, if we want to save some power in sleep, that we turn off completely the camera, it can be in a different power domain. The same can go with the SD card. If we use something like enable signal here for the SD card pins, it is in a different power domain. So every time signals are crossing these power domains, we need to make sure that we have backfeeding under control, that we know what's going on. Looking at this block diagram here, I can already say that the RS232 here in between, we have to be really careful, because RS232 is an interface in which the signals are high in idle. So it's an idle high bus. You have between 5 and 15 volts in idle on RS232. So this is really prone to backfeed. Or we have the HDMI, in which the differential pair, the DDMS signals, they are lifted up to 3.3 volt. So again, this can backfeed. So we have to be really careful on these signals. What is if we have already built our prototype and we see some backfeeding? How can we figure out where the backfeeding is coming from? Let's say here, that's an artificial example here, that we have a wording board here and an RS232 interface, and we measure here 1 volt, let's say, at the power 1.8 volt Mach-E as a residual voltage when the whole module here is turned off. So we have unexpectedly here at this output from the module still 1 volt, and we want to know where it is coming from. I mean, the first and most obvious thing we want to do is trying to unplug peripherals and see how it behaves. We have seen that already on the video when we unplugged the USB, the whole blinking and LEDs weren't turned off, so the USB was backfeeding. The same here, maybe you unplug the RS232 here and the backfeeding is gone. So that's already a first indication that the backfeeding is originated by the RS232. But we may want to know which pin it is actually, or which pins they are backfeeding. There's one thing we already know, that since the backfeeding is coming over these diodes, that means the actual pin, which is the source of the backfeeding, needs to be around 200 to 300 volts higher than the residual voltage. So that means if we measure here 1 volt at this output here, we are searching for a pin that has about 1.2 to 1.3 volts. That will be the source. So we can go through the pins and check which pins are having a higher voltage than the actual residual voltage. That will be the one. The same goes on this side here, because I know already the backfeeding is probably coming from the right side here through the transceiver here. So we can also check on this side here which pin is higher. Something that is really kind of, I always like to know if I see some backfeeding, if I have identified a backfeeding pin, is I want to know how much current there is. Because if it's only a few microamps, probably the issues are not that big. But if it's a couple of tenths of milliamps, the problem is, or the issue is probably higher on this. The easiest way, of course, if you have some series resistor, just measure the voltage drop and you know the current. That is really obvious. But what if you don't have any series resistor on your device? So what I'm doing is, or what my method is, that I'm just gently adding some extra load to the I/O pins. And I really need to be gently, because I don't want to overload this output drivers here. I don't want to destroy them. So I go with a resistor value that only does a few hundred millivolts of drop usually. So maybe in this case here, I figured out that when I add 100 ohm resistor here, the voltage drops by 200 millivolts. And with that, I can actually use this really rough formula to estimate the current that we have. So, or the output impedance of the driver here. And with the output impedance driver, I can estimate the backfeeding current. So with these numbers here, we have in this example here, we measure that the internal resistance here is roughly about 14 ohms, and our backfeeding is probably around 30 milliamps in our example here. If we have identified a pin that is backfeeding, one thing that I want to know is whether it's the only pin, or I should expect more pins to backfeed. For that, One method I'm using is I want to estimate how strong the backfeeding is or how strong the residual voltage is. So when you have this IO rail here, which is lifted up to a certain voltage, I want to know how strong that is. I can do that with a similar way as discussed before by adding some extra load. So again, I'm adding gently some load and see what internal resistance my source has. So by just adding this resistor, looking that only a little drop in the voltage, I can use again this formula. It's not a perfect formula, it's just an estimation. And I can figure out what is the total internal resistance of the backfeeding. And in this case here, in this example, I got about 4.5 ohms. I can then compare these 4.5 ohms with the 14 ohms I have seen before on a single pin. And I can already estimate, okay, in this situation, there are probably three similar pins backfeeding and contributing to the overall backfeeding. So that helps me to figure out whether I found all the backfeeding pins or not. With that, I would like to have our second poll. I would like to know from you whether you have used already any of these backfeeding methods in the past. There are actually multiple answers possible. So first option is you have used this unplugging method. That's just to unplug the peripherals and see what happens. Or you have searched the backfeeding by just searching for the highest IO voltage or voltage on an IO pin. Or you have actually used this kind of overloading methods. Maybe you have your own methods. If so, I would be really happy if you can share it in the chat, because I'm really curious to hear what methods you are using. And of course, maybe you haven't been done any backfeeding hunting in the past so far. Okay, I keep running it for a few more seconds. Thank you very much. I'm going to close it and share with you the results. Okay, so most of you have used the obvious solution, just unplugging peripherals and see where it is coming from. And I'm happy to hear that 20% of you have also used this method of loading pins and see what's happening. And for the 2% of you, I'm really curious to hear what you're doing or how you're doing backfeeding, because I'm also open to learn every day. Okay, with that, we are going into different methods of preventing backfeeding. So, of course, there are countless methods of preventing backfeeding, and some methods are working in for some signals from some signal types, while others are not. Of course, some of them are really expensive. You try to avoid it or need a lot of real estate. And very often it's actually quite hard and expensive to avoid backfeeding entirely. So which means you may just want to reduce the backfeeding current to prevent any potential damages. So with that, the first and most obvious way to prevent backfeeding is to try to keep things on the same domain. Which means if you turn off the peripheral together with the module, you're not having any backfeeding. Of course, that's not always possible. But if you use, for example, our Verdin modules, you can use this power 1.8 Mach, which is coming out from the module to power your peripherals. And with that, your peripheral rails are turning off together with the module rails. The same goes with the controller and control power enable Mach signal, which is a control signal for switching peripherals on your carrier board. And that signal is available on Palis and Verdin modules. So if you're using that, you're already kind of on a safer side in terms of backfeeding. Another thing is that you can do in software, and especially if you have backfeeding from your SOC or module to peripheral, is that you make sure that your IO pins are in the correct state. so that you're not driving them high. So try to set your pins low or high set before going into this off situation. So this is really a method that you should do when you have peripherals that you want to set into sleep mode. Make sure that the software puts the IO pins into a correct stage. Set them high set. Another thing that you have to check is maybe you're already using some, or you have the option to use inputs which have which are not having a backfeeding path, because some inputs, they are having a different protection method. Instead of using these two diodes, they may use internally just some center diode instead. An example for it is the USB 1 VBUS signal you can find on our modules, like the Apalis and Verdin module. These signals are actually not having a backfeeding path, so we are allowed to provide voltage to it, even though the module itself is powered off. But very often it's not easy to identify such pins. One way is that when you go into the data sheet of the peripheral device or the SoC or anything, that you check for the absolute maximum voltages. And if you don't find one of these formulas here, the chances are what we are there that this is not a backfeeding one, but it's not guaranteed. So we have really to check carefully. There is another example here. These are 6 pin compatible RS232 transceivers. And in the datasheet, you don't find any information whether they are backfeeding or not. But we tested them. 6 of them, they are backfeeding from the RS232 side to the TTL side, while the other 3 are not backfeeding at all. So try to use the ones which are not backfeeding and not the ones which are backfeeding. But as I said, the only way to figure out which ones are backfeeding and which ones not was really kind of testing them, unfortunately. Another thing that is maybe doable, especially when you have already built your board, is just to increase the series resistor. I mean, of course, that only works for low speed signals and if your input impedance allows it. And it will not entirely prevent backfeeding, but at least it reduces the current and maybe put it to a level that is acceptable. The one thing that you have to be really careful, or that you should do, is when you have open drain signals, that you make sure that your pull-up resistors are on the correct voltage domain. So again, if you use a Verdin, the best way is to use the power 1.8 volt Mocky as a pull-up, or maybe you can even use the pull-up resistors that are built into the SoC pin. So a lot of SoC pins, they have configurable pull-up resistors. So when you use one of these, you actually are also golden in terms of backfeeding. And of course, you can also use the power enable Mocky to turn on and off power rail for the pull-up resistor. But sometimes it is not possible on open drain signals to move the pull-up resistor, because maybe it is a built-in one on the board, on a separate board, or it is built into the chip. So what you can do is using this transistor circuit here for open drain signals. This transistor circuit here is actually working quite well for I2C if you're not going too high speed. It can even work as a level shifter, so you could even have here on the right side, you could have higher voltages like 5.4, 3.3 volts. So you could even use that circuit here as a level shifter. Another method is to add a blocking diode here and a pull-up resistor, which basically makes nothing else or does transform this push-pull output here to a kind of open drain output. Of course, that only works for lower speed signals, and you have to be really careful with the maximum input high input low level that the receiver here allows, because this this diode here has some extra forward voltage drop, which makes the zero not going to be precisely zero. And this circuit here can also work as a simple level shifter, as a really cheap and simple level shifter. Another circuit that I use is a double transistor circuit here, which basically does nothing else here than also make it an open drain. It can also be used as a level shifter. And maybe you're lucky that you only need one transistor here if you can change the polarity of the signal in the software itself. Another thing that you can do is using tri-state buffers. I mean, the tri-state buffer itself is probably not the best solution, but a lot of transceivers and drivers that already have output enables. For example, an RS-232 transceiver very often have an output enable. So you could use this output enable to make sure that you turn off your output when going into sleep mode or off mode of the module. The only tricky part is actually generating this output enable signal that you may have to make sure that it is really going down at the or disabled at the correct stage. Another method which is really working well, especially if you already use level shifter, is to make sure that you use level shifters that are preventing backfeeding. So there are level shifters on the market which do not backfeed. They are kind of allow you to switch off the IO rails independently and then really don't backfeed. So for example, this TI device here or this onsemi device here, we know for sure they're not backfeeding. They're working really well in this term to prevent backfeeding. But again, here, the trick is a little bit to figure out when you select the level shifter, whether it's really kind of working this way, whether it really kind of prevents on backfeeding. I mean, looking at this TI data sheet, you see that on in section 9.3.3, there is a small sentence that it prevents backflow current in partial power down. Partial power down means if one side is powered off. Or this other, this I2C level shifter here, also just in a sentence says that it allows to have, or it goes into high impedance states if either side is at zero. So really you have to dig into the data sheets to figure out whether a device is backfeeding or not, or maybe even have to try it out. Another really common solution is using galvanic isolation. So this is really a common solution for Ethernet. So the magnetics of the Ethernet, they're preventing us from backfeeding. Or if you have a CAN transceiver or a CAN transformer, it also prevents for backfeeding. It's a preferred method for harsh environments, and it can be done over optocoupler or even specialized ICs like these I-couplers that you find on the market. It's one of my last ones, is that you can put a reverse current protection into the rail. So that means you add here a diode to make sure that the current doesn't go back into the IO rail. Of course, that is something that is a bit hard to do when you're here on a module. It's more kind of on a peripheral, but it is actually a very common solution for HDMI EDIT. So the EDIT port is the DDC that you read out from the player or from the board, the source of the HDMI. You can read out the screen DDC. And for that, the board has to provide to the screen, to the monitor, it has to provide power. But unfortunately, this can backfeed. So what you find very often is a diode here in this power rail to protect any current flowing back. Well, actually, it was the second last, because this one is my last prevention method. It is kind of a last resort. So it is like a workaround if everything else is not working. So the idea is to add an extra load to mitigate the the residual voltage on the peripheral rail. It is something that you can do with a switched resistor. Sometimes even some buck converters, they have a discharge function. So they actually have an active load that they add when it's turned off. The problem with that is you have to be really, really careful that you don't overload your output drivers or your ESD diodes here. And it's mainly helping you when you have problems with power on or strapping problems. And it is preferable that you try to add this resistor only during power-up sequence, not all the time, because it could also increase your power consumption. So it's really kind of a last resort, but it's definitely one which I've already used in the past just to make sure, because everything else was not working because there was no other way to mitigate the backfeeding issues. With that, I would like to come to my last poll just before we have the example. So I would like to know from you, what do you think would be an acceptable residual voltage on a 3.3 volt rail? So is it going to be maximum 0.1 volts, 0.2, 0.4, 0.8 or 1.6 volt? What do you think, what you would accept on a 3.3 volt IO rail? Okay, I will keep it running for a few more seconds. Okay, I'm going to close it and share with you the results. Okay, it was actually a trick question, or a question which doesn't have a correct answer, because it really depends. It really depends on the situation where your thresholds are, your power on threshold, power on reset thresholds, or strapping thresholds. But there is kind of a rule of thumb, and most of you really agree with me. So it is kind of, yeah, around 0.3 volt is probably still acceptable. But it really depends. So everything above 0.3, 0.4 volt, I would say, yeah, it is probably causing issues. And I would really kind of hunt and check what is whether we can mitigate it. With that, I'm going to close that poll, and we are going into the last section. We are going to have some fun to really understand what is going on this board here. So why the LEDs are on here on that board, why they are kind of blinking when you unplug the power, how does this backfeeding occur here on that board. It is an Iris board here, that is using a Colibri module on top, and this is the relevant schematics of this board. So what we have here is we have two buck converters. We have a 3.3 volt buck converter and a 5 volt buck converter. We have here this LDO here, which provides some standby voltage for some control, also powers these two buck converters. So the control part of the buck converter itself are powered with that V supply. That's the main input. That's this connector we have seen that is unplugged here. And then on the right side here, we have the schematic part of the USB. So we have an OTG port here. That is the USB port that we have seen. OTG means that it can be either host or client. So if it is a host, so that you, for example, plug in a USB thumb drive to it, then this one here connects the ID pin to ground when you connect it as a host. The ID pin here then makes sure that the enable goes low here, which turns on the 5-volt switch here, which makes sure that we get 5-volt to the USB port so that our thumb drive that we plugged in gets powered. But in the situation we had before, it is using the other way around. So our board is a client. A client means that we are connected to a host PC, and the 5-volt is coming from the host PC going here. And the ID pin here is actually floating, which means this 3.3 volt pull-up here does disable the switch. So the switch here blocks the current here going in. But what happens now if we unplug the main V supply filtered here? So the main V filtered goes down here. Of course, this buck converter on which all the module is running, the 3.3 volt also goes down. And since the 3.3 volt goes down, our pull-up here goes down, which is then the enable pin here, which is go down. And since this is an active low input here, that means our switch turns on. So there is suddenly current going to the backwards. We're having our backward current going into the 5-volt buck converter here. And now there is something really interesting happen on that board here. So the buck converter itself, it's turned on with the V standby here. V standby here is used to enable that buck converter. There's quite some capacitance here on that V standby and not a lot of current here on it. So that means that V standby is still on. So the buck converter is still up and running. And the thing what happens here is something that is really kind of unusual, but the buck converter acts in reverse now. So the buck converter acts as a boost converter in that situation. So we are having here about 5 volt coming from USB with all these losses here. We may be going down to 4.6, 4.8 volt here on this rail. But our boost converter here, it boosts it up to around 6 volt. So it's really kind of the buck converter, which acts now as a boost converter in reverse direction. And since that boost converter created now a 6 volt here on the V supply, we are supplying here that V standby further, which then still keeps this buck converter on and makes sure that the 3.3 volt buck converter is back alive. It has everything to start again, which makes then the 3.3 volt coming again. And since the 3.3 volt coming again, we are having again this pull-up resistor, which makes then this this enable pin going up. And since the enable pin goes up, we turn off the switch again. So the whole thing stops again. Of course, since it stops, the 3.3 volt goes down again, and the whole thing turns on again. So we're going really into that oscillating mode now. So it really turns on and off and on and off. The module actually tries to just boot in the meantime, but then of course it fails because the power goes away. I even tried to shorten this enable pin to ground to see what's happening if we just don't turn it off again, off of it. With that, the whole board could be working over USB unintentionally. So the board would actually boot. So what did we do to mitigate the problem? So we had to break this loop. And one way to break it was to make sure that this 5 volt buck converter is not enabled when the current is coming back here. Because we cannot really avoid this switch here. If we don't change it to another switch here, we cannot avoid it because it's enable low one, and that signal goes low, obviously. So the only way was to make sure that this one is not active. So what we did is we changed the enable here to be enabled from the 3.3 volt power good instead of the V standby. So when that one here is turning off and that one turns off first, it actually turns off also the 5 volt. And this makes sure that the backfeeding still goes until the 5 volt rail, but then doesn't go further. That was the way how we were able to resolve the issue. Okay, that was a really interesting one because when I saw that, when I measured it, I was really kind of surprised that my buck converter acts as a boost converter. I mean, I learned in school that buck and boost converters are basically the same, just in reverse order. But I've never seen a buck converter which can really act as a boost converter in a circuit. I mean, this was a backfeeding not over I/O pins, it was over some power pins, but still a really interesting case I wanted to share with you. With that, we can go now into the question and answer session. So I've seen you have already posted quite some questions, and I'm now trying to answer them. So the first question I got was, what can be done on a board to protect against backfeeding? Well, a lot of things we have already seen in my section of the backfeeding part. And the most important thing is really kind of try to keep everything on the same power domain. So if you use our Palis and Verdin boards or modules, try to really use these power enable Mocky or even output rail from the module for your peripherals to make sure that there is no backfeeding. And really try to figure out whether there's any way to use, for example, RS-232 transceivers, which are not backfeeding, or anything like that. Next question I got, which are the most problematic interfaces in terms of backfeeding? So in my experience, the RS-232 is the one that is really kind of prone to backfeeding, because on the RS-232, as well as on the TTL side, the UART side, on the other side of the transceiver, both interfaces are idle high. So both interfaces are on a high stage when they are idle, which is really against what we tried to do. So I told you, try to make sure that signals are driven low when the other side is turned off. But since an RS-232 is actually idle high, very often you have problems with RS-232. So you have to be really careful with it. Another thing is HDMI. We have also seen on this block diagram, because HDMI has two ways to backfeed. First of all, it is the TDMS signals. So the differential pair signals, there are on the HDMI, they're lifted to 3.3 volt. So that one can backfeed. That is something, for example, a DisplayPort doesn't do, because DisplayPort has even a series capacitor in their signal lines. So that is really completely blocked from backfeeding. Another problem with HDMI is that HDMI has the DDC part. So that's an I2C bus to read out the information of the display from the board. And that one is running on 5 volt. It has pull-ups. And depending on the screen, there are extra pull-ups on the screen itself, on the display, which can backfeed. You also have then the power rail. So officially, you are sending power to the display to read out the EEPROM that is on the display. Even if the display is powered off, that is the original idea of the HDMI interface. Unfortunately, many displays, they're also powering that 5 volt internally, so that you basically have two 5 volts coming together. And in this situation, one thing you should actually do is making sure that you use, for example, diode on your board to prevent the backfeeding. What else? Yeah, USB can be backfeeding. It's basically all these signals which are high in a certain stage. How can we monitor power domains crossing on chips? Well, this is a really good question, and it's a really tricky one, because you really have to understand the chips itself. So you have to dig into the data sheet and figure out whether they give you any information regarding that. As I said, for example, the USB transceiver we have seen, there was not really any information in the data sheets of these RS-232 transceivers. There was no information whether it's backfeeding or not, but they're having two different voltage domains, obviously. They're having the RS-232 side and they're having the TTL side, but there was no information. So it's very often really hard to figure out whether there is actually any crossing or what they did with the crossing. Okay, next question. We are going to use Verdin IMX 8 M Plus on one of our new projects. As I studied the datasheet, GPIOs are usually 1.8 volt, but some of them are tolerant and accept 3.3 or even 5 volt. If we apply 5 volt to one of these tolerant pins, would it be possible to have issues with backfeeding even if we don't turn off the IO rail, which is 1.8 volt? This is a really good question, and I'm kind of glad that you asked it, because that is really something that These are really pins that are not backfeeding, because in order to get an IO pin tolerant, you actually have really to make sure that there is no protection diode on the upper side, because otherwise, yeah, it would not be tolerant. So on these pins, you can be sure that they're not backfeeding. So these pins are really, you're okay with these pins. So if a pin is set, it is a 1.8 volt pin, but it is 3.3 or even 5 volt tolerant, backfeeding is not a problem because it really has an input that is backfeeding protected. Another question is, can I use a thermal camera for hunting backfeeding? Yes, this is actually also a good idea, especially if you have some stronger backfeeding and you have a camera that is quite sensitive. So you can actually check whether something gets warm, because if there is some backfeeding and you know that you're having, let's say, 100 milliwatts of backfeeding, that 100 milliwatts need to go somewhere, and you can use your thermal camera, if you have one, to check which interface or which chip gets warm, to already know, okay, in which direction it goes. Preventing methods. You recommended extra BOM. Should it be foreseen in the chip, IO? Well, the chip IO, of course, the manufacturers, they don't know what how you're going to use the chip. So that is probably the reason why they don't do already prevention on it. So yeah, of course, backfeeding protection sometimes costs you some extra BOM. And maybe you want to do some assembly options if you don't know in the beginning whether there is a potential backfeeding or not. So yeah, unfortunately, sometimes it is needed that you need extra BOM cost. Can the Toradex modules get damaged by backfeeding? Well, theoretically, yes. We can, as I said, we can overload the IO pins. There could be some latch up, etc. Fortunately, I don't really remember that I have seen a case that I can, and I absolutely know that it was damaged by backfeeding. But of course, we get back broken modules, and in the end, you don't know why it happens, because we don't know what our customers were doing with these modules. So I cannot tell you for sure that we never had it. I know that I never really had, I mean, I never seen really something that is really absolutely broken due to backfeeding, but it's definitely something you have to keep an eye on. Can backfeeding increase the power consumption? Absolutely. So in standby or in power off, if you have some backfeeding, this can massively increase power consumption. It can also increase power consumption in the RTC rail or anything like that. So you have to be careful that, to make sure that you don't have enough, too much backfeeding and increase your current consumption. How do these added resistors or diodes affect the signals then? I mean, we do change the impedance of signal path, which even could be a transmission line. That's a really good question and a good remark. Of course, a lot of these methods, like changing the series resistor, adding a diode, or something like that, they are completely changing the impedance of our signals. And it's definitely something we want to do only for low-speed signals that have high impedance path. This is really important. That doesn't really work for anything. The good thing is, if we change the series resistor, we make the signal such a high impedance, and the slew rates are going so slow that you're not going to have any kind of issues with EMC on that line anymore. So it is, impedance control will be completely off, but since the slew rate is going so slow, you shouldn't have any problems with it. But of course, it only works when you really have like static signals or anything that is really not fast. Okay, with that, I think I have covered all the questions that came up. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you have learned something. The thing is that a lot of what I have talked about, you will find in our design guide. I added in our carrier board design guides for Apalis, Colibri, and Verdin. I added a section which talks about backfeeding, and it should cover things that we have talked today. It even had some more backfeeding prevention methods I haven't covered today. So check out our design guides. You find them under developer.toradex.com. So thank you very much for your attention. Have a good day, afternoon, weekend. Thank you.